of heightened ecological consciousness. Never before have we felt so alienated from nature. Despite our domination of the natural world through technology, there's a pervading sense that we have in turn lost touch with our environment. But what exactly is nature? The question is not as simple as it might appear. When we think of nature, we tend to think of rolling hills, trees, and wildlife. But this is an idea that we really owe to the Romantics. The Romantics were a collection of writers, thinkers, and artists who were interested in the relationship between man and nature. Their work was a reaction to a world that was becoming increasingly industrialized, a world in which man's relationship to nature was, as they perceived it, being undermined by the rationalization and categorization of the new Enlightenment thinkers. What the Romantics attempted to do was to bridge the gap between subject and object, that is, between man and the natural world. In his lines on Tintern Abbey, the eminent Romantic poet William Wordsworth wrote of a motion and a spirit that impels all thinking things, all objects of all thought. For Wordsworth and for many of the Romantics, the reconciliation of subject and object is negotiated through a quasi-pantheism in which the speaker, if only for a moment, perceives himself as being one with nature. But this idea of nature is still dependent on the idea that it's possible for man to be separate from nature in the first place. Nature here undergoes a kind of aesthetic framing. We see it as something outside of us, which we can choose to indulge in, but only if we want to. But with this aesthetic framing comes a psychological distance, which may be counterintuitive to our efforts towards improving the planet. If we look at nature in this way, we tend to legitimize its problems by chalking them up as a necessary defect. What we need is a more immediate engagement with nature. The first step towards a working philosophy of ecology is the abandonment of the romantic concept of nature and the recognition of our true place within it, not on Mont Blanc, but on the landfill.
This is where we should start feeling at home.
We tend to perceive human activity as a perversion of nature, forgetting that we are ourselves a part of it. Nature is not something that exists outside of us, it is us. After hundreds of years, we're close to realizing this. When we boil organic matter down to the essential algorithmic processes of which it's made, it begins to resemble less and less the squishy nature that we associate with the Romantics, and more the mechanical structure of technology. When this happens, the distinction between what is natural and what isn't becomes a bit blurry, and we have a harder time framing nature as something outside of us. Philosopher Timothy Morton has termed this realization dark ecology. This is the paradoxical idea that, in order to save our environment, we must first abandon the idea of nature. Instead, we should confront the ecological devastation we have wreaked without viewing it as a perversion of nature, but as a problem with the system, a syntax error which must be fixed.
So I think that what we should do to confront properly the threat of ecological catastrophe is not all this new age stuff to break out of this technological manipulative mold and to found our roots in nature, but on the contrary, to cut off even more these roots in nature.
Without the idea of nature to help us digest the grief of a troubled planet, we are given no other choice but to change the environment for the better. It's through this abstract materialism which views a landfill to be as natural as a tree that we achieve the kind of subject-object synthesis which the Romantics saw, only by opposite means. As bleak as it sounds, we need to sit with our guilt and let it force us to take action. This is not the guilt of a perpetrator who's committed a crime, but the guilt which arises from the realization that we are both perpetrator and victim.